Hello everyone, this is Deva Harini. My today's topic is about vitamin E and vitamin K. So in this topic, you people will get some ideas about how these vitamins are important in their functions and how their actions are impacted. I have covered all the topics you should know under these vitamins along with the important questions and a clinical case scenario to relate with these vitamins. Before going on the topic, you should know what does the term vitamin means. Vitamins are the organic compounds which are taken in the diet in small amounts. This vitamin is divided into fat-soluble and water-soluble vitamins. In the fat-soluble vitamins, today we are going to see about the vitamin E and vitamin K in detail in the upcoming slides. So we will go in an order which will be easy for you guys to understand. That is, firstly we will have a case scenario, then a small intro about these two vitamins, that is the vitamin E and vitamin K. Then we will start off with its chemistry, that is the chemical formula of these vitamins, then its dietary sources, the recommended daily allowance, how it is absorbed, transported, where it is stored, what are their biochemical function, if the person is already having an underlying disease, how will be the risk factors related to its function. What are their deficiency symptoms? To know or confirm with a particular deficiency, what investigations you must do? After confirming with the investigations, how will you proceed with the treatment? So to get answer for all these questions, come on, let's move on to the topic. Case scenario. A 25-year-old woman who delivered a term infant at her home itself. The infant was normal up to 2 weeks, after which she developed severe bleeding from her umbilical stump. Her parents were directed to the emergency department immediately. So what could be the probable diagnosis? At the end, I will discuss the diagnosis of this case briefly. So we are moving on to the topic. Vitamin E and vitamin K, together called as the fat-soluble vitamins, as they both are associated with fat so that they can be stored in the liver and adipose tissue. Vitamin E, which is also called as the tocopherol. The term tocopherol was given by Even and his associate, in which tocos means childbirth, pheros means to bear, ol means alcohol. The four important points you should remember in vitamin E is that it is a naturally occurring antioxidant. It is also called the anti-sterility vitamin as it prevents sterility, which is essential for the normal reproductive function. Vitamin E is described as vitamin in search of a disease. This is due to the lack of any specific vitamin E deficiency diseases in human. A type of vitamin E, which is also called as the vitamin E acetate, has been linked to a serious lung injury. Now we will see about vitamin K. The two important points you should remember in vitamin K is that the two B's and the two C's. The two B's are, it is involved in the blood clotting process and the bone metabolism. The two C's are, it serves as a coenzyme and it regulates the blood calcium levels. First, we'll start off with vitamin E, its chemistry. Vitamin E is the name given to a group of tocopherols and tocotrienols. About 8 tocopherols have been identified, such as alpha, beta, gamma, delta, and so on, among which the alpha tocopherol is the most active form. The common thing among these tocopherol is the presence of the isoprenoid side chain. This is an isoprenoid side chain and the chromane ring. The chromane ring gives the antioxidant property, and the difference between the three tocopherol is the presence of the methyl group in the position of 5, 7 and 8. In the exam point of view, you need not to write this chemical structure, but you should know about the three types of tocopherol along with its chemical formula, which is C29H50O2. Dietary sources. The rich sources of the vitamin E are the vegetable oils, such as wheat germ oil, cottonseed oil, peanut oil, corn oil and the sunflower oil, and along with some foods like meat, poultry, eggs, milk and butter. It is also available as a supplement. So here is a question of how does this work? Vitamin E is an important vitamin which is required for the proper function of many organs. And I have said that it is an antioxidant. This means that it helps to slow down the processes which damages the cells. Recommended daily allowance. The intake of vitamin E is directly related to the consumption of polyunsaturated fatty acids, so that the requirement increases with the increased intake of polyunsaturated fatty acids. a daily consumption of 10 microgram per day is required for men and 8 microgram per day is required for women. And vitamin E supplements is also required for pregnant and lactating women. Absorption, transport and storage. Vitamin E is absorbed along with the fat in the small intestine, for which the bile salts are also required. After they get absorbed into the small intestine, they enter into the circulation so that they can be stored in the liver, muscle and the adipose tissue. In the liver, they are stored as lipoproteins, that is the VLDL and LDL. The normal plasma level of tocopherol is less than 1 mg per deciliter. Biochemical function. One of the most important function is its antioxidant property. That is, it prevents the peroxidation of polyunsaturated fatty acids in various tissues and membrane. That is, it protects the red blood cells from hemolysis. Vitamin E is lipophilic in character. That is, it is found in association with lipoproteins, which prevents the oxidation of LDL. So what happens when this LDL is oxidized? It promotes the heart disease, such as hardening of the arteries and high blood pressure. Vitamin E acts as a scavenger. That is, it gets itself oxidized to a quinine form by free radicals and spares the polyunsaturated fatty acid. Vitamin E preserves and maintains the germinal epithelium of gonads, which is required for the proper reproductive function. So what is its important in other organs is that in muscles, it is important for the proper storage of creatinine. In intestine, it is needed for the optimal absorption of amino acids. In liver, it is protected from being damaged by toxic compounds such as carbon tetrachloride. In cells, it is required for the cellular respiration through the electron transport chain. It increases the synthesis of heme by enhancing the enzyme 6-aminolevulinic acid synthase and the aminolevulinic acid dehydratase. It is also involved in synthesizing the nucleic acid. So what is its relation with selenium? Is that the element selenium, which is found in the enzyme glutathione peroxidase, destroys the free radical, which the vitamin E also does. So the vitamin E and selenium are synergistic in action. So what is its relation with vitamin A and vitamin C is that it prevents the oxidation of these vitamins so that it delays the onset of cataract. In higher doses, it is given in the Alzheimer's disease, asthma and the fatty liver disease. Risk factor, where the deficiency can occur at a higher rate. In chronic pancreatitis, when there is an inflammation of the pancreas, the bile salts which is necessary for the vitamin E absorption is not produced. And in some malabsorption disease such as Crohn's disease and primary biliary cirrhosis and cystic fibrosis. Along with this, cholestasis and short bowel syndrome. Deficiency symptom. In a vitamin E deficient patient, there will be loss of hair, dry skin, blindness, anemia, the muscular weakness and the impairment in the reproductive function and the leg cramps. As I have said, it is important in the reproductive function. Deficiency can lead to sterility, which have been proven only in animals. Vitamin E is important in maintaining the muscle strength. Deficiency will lead to the muscular weakness. When there is a vitamin E deficiency, the free radicals are generated, which will lead to immune impairment and cancer. And a condition called encephalomalacia, where there will be softening or loss of brain tissue, is also seen. Megaloblastic anemia and some minor neurological symptoms such as sensory loss, ataxia, which is the impairment in balance, and retinitis pigmentosa is also seen. Investigations. Serum alpha tocopherol level is assessed. The normal is about 5.5 to 17 mg per liter. Treatment. Vitamin E is given orally or parenterally. For the people of low concentration of bile salt, cannot be able to absorb the oral preparations. So for them, intramuscular administration is necessary. Will there be any side effects? Or what will happen if you give an overdosage is that among the fat soluble vitamins A, D, E, K, vitamin E is the least toxic. But one serious side effects can be seen, which is the hemorrhagic stroke. And some other side effects are the hardening of the arteries and the high blood pressure. Now we are moving on to the next topic, which is the vitamin K. We'll start off with its chemistry. Vitamin K exists in three different forms. That is the vitamin K1, which is also called as the phylloquinone, vitamin K2, which is also called as the minoquinone, vitamin K3, which is also called as the minandione. These three vitamins are the naphthoquinone derivatives and they are stable to heat. The common thing in these three vitamins are the presence of the isoprenoid side chain, which is absent in the vitamin K3. Their activity can be lost by the oxidizing agents, irradiation, strong acids and the alkalis. Dietary sources. Vitamin K1 is present in plants, so it is obtained from green leafy vegetables such as spinach, cabbage and broccoli. Whereas vitamin K2 is produced by the interstitial bacteria and found in animals, so that it is obtained from compounds like cheese, eggs, natos and meat, whereas vitamin K3 is in synthetic form. Here, vitamin K1 is the main type of dietary vitamin, whereas vitamin K2 is a lesser source. So here is the question of why should you take vitamin K? Is that when there is a lower level of vitamin K, it can lead to increased risk of uncontrolled bleeding, which can commonly seen in newborn infants. So a single injection of vitamin K is necessary for the newborn infants. Recommended daily allowance. Strictly speaking, there is no recommended daily allowance for vitamin K. As I have said, it can be adequately synthesized in the gut. But a daily of about 70 to 140 mcg per day is taken by the adults, which depends upon the age and gender of the person. Absorption, transport and storage. Vitamin K absorption is similar to that of the vitamin E absorption. That is, vitamin K and fat are together absorbed into the small intestine, for which bile salts are required. After they get absorbed into the small intestine, they enter into the circulation so that they can be stored in the liver as LDL and to a lesser extent in some other tissues. When a vitamin K1 type of food is taken, the bacteria present in the large intestine converts it into a storage form, which is the vitamin K2, so that it can be stored in the liver and fatty tissues. Biochemical function. One of the most important function is it is involved in the blood clotting factors. So before going on to the blood clotting factors, you should know what are the blood clotting factors. That is the factor 1, which is called as the fibrinogen. Factor 2 is the prothrombin. Factor 3 is the tissue thromboplastin. Factor 4 is the calcium ions. Factor 5 is the label factor. Factor 6 is not present. Factor 7 is the stable factor. Factor 8 is the anti-hemophilic factor. Factor 9 is the Christmas factor. Factor 10 is the Stuart-Truwer factor. Factor 11 is the plasma thromboplastin antecedent. Factor 12 is the Hagemann factor. Factor 13 is the fibrin stabilizing factor. So to remember these clotting factors, there is a mnemonic, which is the freshers party today. Come on, let's sing and call the seniors. Please have fun. In blood clotting process, it brings about the post-translational modification of these clotting factors. It promotes the bone calcification by improving the bone density. It involves in the cell growth and it improves the episodic memory in older adults. It supports the heart health. How is that? It lowers the blood pressure by preventing the mineralization, so that it also lowers the risk of the stroke. It acts as a coenzyme in the carboxylation of the glutamic acid residues in proteins, and this reaction is catalyzed by the carboxylase, which is present in microsomal. Now we will see the relation between the coagulation pathway and the vitamin K cycle. When there is a damaged surface, the intrinsic pathway is activated so that the factor 12, 11, 9 is converted into their active form, that is the 12A, 11A and 9A. When there is a trauma, the extrinsic pathway is activated so that the factor 7 is converted into factor 7A. These two factors, that is the 9A and 7A, are involved in the conversion of factor 10 to factor 10A. When there is an involvement of factor 5A here, there is a conversion of prothrombin to thrombin, that is factor 2 to factor 2A, which involves the conversion of the fibrinogen to fibrin, which is the clot. It will be more easy if we understand the vitamin K cycle. The vitamin K, which is absorbed into the small intestine, is converted into vitamin K hydroquinone by the enzyme vitamin K reductase. This vitamin K hydroquinone is converted into vitamin K epoxide, for which the gamma carboxylase is required. in this gamma carboxylase, there is a conversion of the clotting factors. The inactive form is converted into the active form of the clotting factors, which are the factor 2, factor 7, factor 10, factor 9. When these are the active form is formed, there is a formation of fibrin. The vitamin K epoxide is converted into vitamin K by the enzyme vitamin K epoxide reductase. When there is a vitamin K antagonist taken, such as warfarin and ticomerol, there is no formation of the active form of clotting factors, so that the fibrin is not formed. Risk factors, where the deficiency can occur at a higher rate, such as alcoholics, and in some malabsorption disease such as Crohn's disease and celiac disease. And when the person take vitamin K antagonists such as dicomoral and warfarin. Vitamin K can interact with several common medications, including the blood thinners, which is the warfarin, and the anticonvulsant drugs such as phenytoin and dilantin, and also the cholesterol lowering medications, and the weight loss drugs, and also certain antibiotics. Deficiency symptoms. One of the most common and important symptom is the bleeding, which is divided into three phases. That is, in early phase, within 24 hours, you can see the bleeding from the scalp, intra-abdominal and the intracranial bleeding. At the classical, that is within 7 days, you can see a nasal bleeding and the bleeding from the umbilical circumcision, mucosal and the gastrointestinal and the intracranial bleeding. At the late phase, that is before 2 weeks, you can see an intracranial bleeding, bleeding from the skin and the bleeding from the GIT. You can see that in all the three phases, there is an involvement of the intracranial bleeding, which can be the epidural, subarachnoid, which can be due to the contusion, or the subdural. Investigations. The prolonged prothrombin time and a delayed clotting time is seen. Treatment. Vitamin K is given in newborns of about 1 mg per kilogram parenterally and in older children of about 2.5 to 10 mg intramuscularly or intravenously. So along with them, infusion of the fresh frozen plasma is also given. Will there be any side effects? Or what will happen if you give an overdosage? Is that in overdosage, a condition called hypervitaminosis K occurs, which will lead to breakdown of the red blood cells and produce the hemolytic anemia and jaundice, which is particularly seen in infants. So now we will see about the case scenario. The diagnosis to the case scenario is vitamin K deficiency. We will see about the key points. The infant born in home, so that the infant might not be receive vitamin K injection. This not received vitamin K injection leads to the abnormal bleeding. So as soon as the infant is born, vitamin K injection is needed. In exam point of view, the short notes can be the functions of the vitamin E and vitamin K and the vitamin K cycle, which we have seen along with the coagulation pathway. Thank you so much for your patience till now. So if you guys can could go back and refer your textbook now, it will be so easy so that you can study them right now itself. Thank you.